Okay, well, welcome everyone to the Equal Opportunities Committee. It's the 18th meeting of 2014. Can I ask everyone to switch off their electronic devices or put them into flight mode, please? I'd like to start with introductions. We are supported at the table by the clerking and research staff, official reporters and broadcasting services, and around the room by security. Today's only agenda is an evidence session on our scrutiny of the draft budget 2015-16. And I'd like to welcome our panel of witnesses. Can I ask you that when you wish to speak during the discussion, could you indicate to myself or my clerk on my left, please? There will be no opening statements, but when you're introducing yourselves, could you give us some brief background information on the role you play within your organisation would be really appreciated. So I'll start by introducing myself. I'm Margaret McCulloch, the committee's convener, and members will now introduce themselves in turn, starting here on my right, then followed by the witnesses.
Good morning, I'm Marco Biaggi. I'm the MSP for Edinburgh Central and the deputy convener of the committee.
Alec Johnston, member for North East Scotland.
Hey, John Mason, MSP for Glasgow Shettleston.
Martin Maher, good morning. John Finney, MSP Highlands and Islands.
Hi, Siobhan McMahon, MSP for Central Scotland.
Good morning, Christian Arad, MSP for North East Scotland.
And I'm Joe McElholm. My role is I'm the manager for older adult services in North Lanarkshire Council, and I'm representing the partnership of North Lanarkshire and NHS Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership today. And the role that I have is to oversee the development of services, the day-to-day operational management of services for older people, but also the strategic development, looking forward to the changes and the future of older people services, but increasingly in an integrated world, kind of obviously working across the full age cycle. So.
Hello, I'm Iona Colvin. I'm the Director of North Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership and the Chief Officer for the partnership. I've been appointed for nearly a year now, and in Ayrshire and Arran we're currently in shadow phase of the Health and Social Care Partnership. So I'm responsible for all of social services within North Ayrshire, all of community health services and all of mental health services for Ayrshire and Arran as the lead partnership director.
I'm Stuart Mercer. I'm a Professor of Primary Care Research at the University of Glasgow, and I am also newly appointed as the Director of the Scottish School of Primary Care, which is a kind of virtual school promoting research into primary care. And my main focus of research is on the needs of people with multiple morbidity or multiple complex long-term conditions. So we look at that across the board, all age groups, largely, of course, from a primary care angle, but lots of important interfaces.
Okay, thank you. We'll start the questioning by John Mason taking the lead, and if you would like to indicate who would like to answer, that would be excellent. Thanks, John.
Thanks, Convener. I appreciate getting to ask some questions. The whole thrust seems to be that we should try and keep older people at home as much as possible, and I think that seems to be widely accepted and has been touched on by a number of committees within the Parliament. And yet when we looked at the funding, I was surprised to see that the statement was made only 7% of the funding for over 65s in the health and social care area is spent on home care. Now, I suppose that could show that it is cheaper, but it could also show we're not putting enough emphasis on that area. So I think to start us off, I just wonder what progress you feel is being made or has been made in shifting the balance of care towards home-based services.
Start with an easy question. I think we've not made as much progress as we would want to make to to start with, basically. And when you look at the balance of funding, particularly if you look at NHS funding, then you see that it's overwhelmingly invested in acute and secondary services, most of it tied up in big district general hospitals, particularly in Ayrshire and Arran's position. We have grown some elements of care at home through the Reshaping Care for Older People Fund, but I don't think that the Reshaping Care for Older People Fund actually managed to influence the mainstream of funding as much as it should have. And what we're doing now is we're looking seriously at how we grow the community infrastructure. It's not just about care at home, it's about district nursing, it's about community psychiatric nursing, it's about really building services around GP practice, I think, and how we, because I see GP practice is absolutely fundamental to all of this. So it's about all of that. And at the moment, we're looking in terms of developing our strategic plans, very much are focused on how do we move the money into the community to actually build and grow care at home. How do we re-specify care at home so that it can take on a broader range of tasks as well, looking to see within the partnerships so that actually we're working alongside our district nurses, working alongside our community psychiatric nurses as well as social work. So I think that we haven't grown it as much as we need to. It's been about trying to shift the balance of care. And to be honest, a lot of that the money has gone into care homes and the growth of care homes, basically the care home sector, rather than into care at home. And what we're doing just now in Ayrshire is we're currently preparing our strategic plans, and they will very much have a focus on how do we do this. Now, that's, you know, there's a bit where you can pull out some efficiencies in terms of what we will manage within the health and social care partnership, because there is some duplication and there are barriers that don't make sense, that as we go through and integrate the services we'll be able to free up some resource. But the big question is how do we get the bigger resource freed up from within the big district general hospitals so that we can begin to invest more in the community. And that's the one that we're all currently working on.
Okay, I don't know if either of the other two want to. Mr. McElholm?
Yeah, I think the 7% figure is quite stark, and if you compare it with the prescribing budget in terms of older people, you know, we spend as much or slightly more, I think, on prescribing in terms of the health budget, and we would really like to see some of that change, you know, kind of a focus around polypharmacy. It's just, you know, one example in terms of how we could actually, where we think there are gains to be made in terms of transfers of resource on out. I think the question around the balance and how we actually support more people at home, it isn't just related to spend, because if you look at the figures in terms of the proportion of people living in care homes, the numbers of 65 plus per thousand who live in care homes across the country, there's really very big variation, and it's not necessarily only related to spend. It is related also to redesign of services and the focus on how we actually take what we have in terms of that existing home support resource and make sure that it is working, it's targeted, and that it's effective, that it's efficient, and that it's well linked to the wider service system. So in most areas, but certainly in North Lanarkshire, we've got a big focus around redesign towards re-ablement, towards ensuring that as people come into using the home support service, we actually work with them in the early stages to see what abilities can they regain, what confidence can they rebuild in order not to use services, so that we're actually helping people to move back out of services, which can in fact be quite an intensive use of resource in the early stages, but it's a resource which you are, you know, spending to save, because by then supporting people back out of the service, over time you free up the resource that you have to support those people who do have much higher levels of support need to remain in their own communities. You know, it also connects to reshaping what we do with the care home, the care home resource. So in North Lanarkshire, we have moved away from providing residential care within a traditional long-term local authority model. So the care homes that we have now are focused around around intermediate care. Two of them are operating fully on intermediate care and two are moving towards that. So we've kind of divested from the long-term residential care model without seeing an increase in the use of, you know, the independent sector care home. So it is possible to actually make those shifts in terms of balance of care by that process of redesign. But clearly, if we are supporting more people to live at home, we have to then also make the wider connection to their quality of life. You know, so one of the focuses within reshaping care is the wider connection to the third sector. How can we actually ensure that we, you know, that we address this question, which is mentioned in some of the written submissions around loneliness in for older people, that we're actually giving people the opportunities by investing in the third sector. And we've been trying to do that in North Lanarkshire through our contacts with voluntary, our engagement with Voluntary Action North Lanarkshire as a full partner in the Reshaping Care programme.
From what you've both said, I get the impression that it maybe is not an even picture right across the country, and that things are being done differently in different parts of the country. And if that is the case, I mean, should there be more of a kind of direction from the centre, or is it right that each local area works out its own, what is best for its own area?
I think all the things that Joe's talked about we've done as well, so it's not either or, to be honest, and re-ablement has been a big focus for most authorities, I think. I think that the integration gives us a better opportunity to use the resources that we've got across the NHS and the council to do that, and to work very much about maximising independence but also getting people into better care and into the position where they are happier, I suppose, in terms of how they live in the future. And one of the things that we are doing is looking at the care home sector and how we work with the care home sector and how we commission services in the future. So Joe's touched on that in terms of intermediate care, but I think it's about one of the things we plan to do in Ayrshire and Arran is to review all of our inpatient beds and our purchase beds together. So all of those that are provided by the NHS, as well as in Ayrshire and Arran, it tends to be outsourced, it tends to be private and independent sector agencies who provide care homes, but to look at the totality of that and to ask the question about what is it we want for the future in terms of citizens of North Ayrshire and East Ayrshire and South Ayrshire in terms of their care. And I think that's about, as Joe has said, about reshaping the care that we currently have and the expectations. So it's about things like extra care housing, which Borders and Lothian have been looking at. So we do look across, we do look at the best examples of practice across different authorities and try to learn from that and look at the extra care housing stuff that actually is quite remarkable in that some of the things that have been achieved about moving people out of residential care into extra care housing. The kind of, I think the opportunity with that model is that you're not moving individuals, but you're actually being able to have much more flexible support and health services round about those individuals. So for me, we need to define and look at how care should be delivered in the future, and that's one of the things that we plan to do in the first 12 months of the partnership becoming a real and legal entity, which will happen next year.
Barriers, I mean, presumably just the kind of, what would you say, status quo or whatever, keeping the big institutions going is a bit of a barrier, is it?
Yes. I mean, basically what happens is that I think what's happened previously is, I don't know, it might be different in Lanarkshire, but what's happened previously is that more and more people come through the hospital and look at the figures in terms of the numbers of people who are turning up at A&E, and that, you know, they've increased year on year, I think, you know, a couple of thousand each year, extra people turning up at Cross House and at Ayr Hospital. There's then real pressure on the beds within the hospital, and I'm sure that Professor Mercer can say more about that. There's then real pressure then to get people back out of hospital as quickly as possible. And obviously, I mean, we think around about a third of the people who turn up at hospital don't need to be there. but two-thirds do. And that relates very clearly to the impact, I think, of deprivation on people's health and on the fact that we've got an older population, which in North Ayrshire we've got the kind of Largs North Coast bit, which is quite affluent and a lot of people who live quite a long time. And then we've got Irvine in the three towns, which is basically fairly deprived. Certain parts of it are, and where we see people's health basically deteriorating in their 40s and their 50s. And all of that leads to a huge challenge for the hospital, and then they in turn have passed that on to us. And I think we still have a culture where quite often we decide, when particularly with older people, when they're in hospital, they're either going down the get home quickly and into care at home route, or they're going down the care home route. And I think that's one of the things that we need to change. And we need to change the options that are available for older people, and we need to change that culture. And also we need to get in about what is it that's happening. And I thought Professor Mercer's paper was helpful in that respect. And that's a lot of what we are trying to look at on a day-to-day basis. What is it that's driving more people to present at hospital? And then the pressure comes on to social care, basically, to help clear the A&E, clear the beds, get people into care homes, get people into care at home. And the demand is increasing year on year. This year we've seen an 11% increase in the demand on care homes and a 7% increase in the demand on care at home. And so it's difficult in this current financial climate to keep up with that. But what we're doing now is we're looking in a much more systemic basis at the whole system. What happens? What is it that's driving people through? What happens when they come through? And what can we do about that? And what points can we intervene? And I think previously we looked at that, but we looked at it from a health perspective and a social care perspective. And actually, we didn't sit down together enough and actually work that out across the system. And that's something that's right now beginning to happen.
I mean, maybe Professor Mercer, can I bring you in? Is there something we should be doing at the parliamentary level, especially at the budget level, which is what we're thinking about, to kind of move this along, or is it going to happen naturally, locally?
I'm not sure if it'll happen naturally, locally. Different areas are different, and that's a kind of historic thing. But I mean, I think the bigger picture is really important, and I try to outline some of the backdrop to all of this in the paper that I sent. So there's just a few things that I think are key. The problem of the elderly is largely to do with having multiple complex conditions, increasingly a mixture of multiple physical and mental health problems, dementia, heart disease, diabetes, osteoporosis, so on and so forth. Now, that's not suddenly going to change. I mean, as the population ages, we're going to get more of that, not less, unless we radically do something about prevention, which is a different task. So here we have, you know, an aging population with multiple complex problems, and 90% of the activity of the NHS is in primary care and general practice. But that doesn't reflect the amount of budget that goes into primary care and general practice. And in fact, the budget, the percentage of the budget going into general practice has decreased over the last 10 years in the UK. And the Royal College of General Practitioners has been calling for a 40% increase in the share. I think that's the kind of context. And GPs are increasingly struggling with their 10-minute consultations, quick throughput of patients who, not like the oldies who came with one condition. People now are turning up and they've got, you know, five or six different conditions. So it's, I think, general practice primary care is absolutely essential to this problem because they provide a generalist service. And for people with multiple conditions, what they need is generalism and holism, not 10 different specialists in 10 different places. So I think there's the bigger picture is that there's a real problem here in primary care being under-resourced for the future as we look ahead. Something's got to change, and it's compounded by deprivation because we know that multimorbidity happens much earlier in deprived areas, 10 to 15 years earlier. So when we talk about elderly, I think we've got to be, it's not necessarily an age cutoff. I think there's a kind of biological age phenomenon here. People in the.
Fixated on
ages like 60, 66?
I think so, because, you know, if somebody in the most deprived decile of Scotland will have the same amount of multimorbidity aged 50 compared with somebody who's 70 in the most affluent areas. So it's not necessarily actual age, it's about healthy life expectancy. So, you know, we have a huge problem of health inequalities in Scotland, you know, the worst in Western Europe, and multimorbidity is compounding that, because particularly in deprived areas, the need is not matched by resource. So the distribution of general practitioners is flat across different deciles of Scotland, different places. But the need, the healthcare need, the healthcare problems in relating to particularly multimorbidity isn't flat. There's a 2 to 3-fold increase between most affluent and most deprived. So we can't possibly expect general practitioners in the deep end, as it's been called, to be able to cope in the same way as if they were working in a more affluent area, because it's not a level playing field. So this has been called the inverse care law, and the GPs in Scotland working in these deprived areas have formed quite a powerful advocacy group called the Deep End. My colleague Graeme Watt at Glasgow University has presented evidence to other committees here on that. So I think that's it. I think that's the bigger picture that has to be taken into account. And as we move into integrated care, then it's absolutely about multidisciplinary teams joining up and each knowing what's going on. And this is a challenge where I think we're still very fragmented, so that we have the GPs often don't know what's happening with a person in terms of their social care and so on. We've got different computer systems, different notes. We don't necessarily speak to each other very often. So all of these things need to be improved. And a lot of it is about having systems that enable you to work better together and to at least share knowledge. But I do think there's a fundamental problem of the relative balance of the budget in terms of acute and primary care. And countries that have got strong primary care systems across the world, we know do better in terms of costs, healthcare costs, and outcomes. So we will not survive into the future without having strong primary care. I mean, all the international evidence points to that. And we have got a fantastic primary care service compared with many other countries, but it is under pressure, and it is socially patterned in the sense that in the more deprived areas, it's, things are just much, much harder.
If you'd like to comment.
Just to come back to Mr. Mason's question about should from Scottish Government be kind of trying to direct more in terms of uniformity, and I think, you know, my kind of thoughts on that are that there's been quite a lot of work done in terms of the reshaping care programme now with the integration programme around the Scottish Government setting out the outcomes that we want to see achieved and then actually handing these outcomes as strategic, the basis for strategic planning and thinking within the partnership areas. Where I think there is scope to improve how we actually direct from the Scottish Government, from direct their input, or the Scottish Government level input, the national level input, is around some of the performance regime that we have, which can, in fact, unintentionally, can mitigate against effective transitions and mitigate against some of the outcomes being achieved. So I'm thinking around, there's huge pressure around the achievement of the 4-hour target in emergency in hospitals. And Iona was talking about the pressures around the emergency departments, A&E departments in hospitals. For many, many older people, and for many of the people who Professor Mercer is talking about in terms of multimorbidities, 4 hours isn't actually very long to actually get a resolution to some of the difficulties which may have brought them into the A&D department. People who have dementia but are there for a separate reason, perhaps, than their dementia. simply trying to actually establish the information, have the conversation, establish the relationship that's needed to actually treat the person in 4 hours, that's a big pressure. And that can actually lead to an unnecessary onward transition into converting that to an admission if people feel under huge pressure to make sure there are not breaches of that target.
Then, so I mean, older
well it's not necessarily age related, because I think it's about multimorbidity, and it's about the complexity of the person's need.
But that's more likely to be the case as people get older.
Yes. But numerically, as Professor Mercer said in his paper, there are more people under 65, which is your point, that these age cutoffs are increasingly less relevant, and particularly in areas of multiple deprivation. Another focus in terms of how targets and performance culture can actually create difficulties and challenges in delivering what we want to do is around the delayed discharge. So once the person is admitted, so at next April, we are still moving towards implementation of a target of 2 weeks from clinical readiness for discharge for the person to leave. We currently report on a target of 4 weeks, and risks actually generating a pressure. So during this period of transition in the hospital, the person may need longer, than 2 weeks. The team supporting them may need longer than 2 weeks. If we try to drive the performance, which is a laudable thing to do around ensuring the most efficient, effective use of the acute resource, but if we drive that very hard on this kind of time-limited target regime, then the risk is that we drive more institutionalization, people a premature declaration of need to move to a care home, when in fact with a different approach we might be able to support the person back home again. So I think that it's a more subtle kind of way of looking at how can Scottish Government work in a partnership way with the local partnerships around the achievement of the outcomes. It's more subtle than actually saying, well, can there be more straight direction? So it's more working in partnership around what's the best way to manage this performance.
Thank you very much for that. That's really interesting. We'll move on now to spending priorities, and Christian Allard would like to ask the first set of questions.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's leaning on about what we talked about early on when we talk about the integration of health and social care. You talked about national outcome, but it's a national outcome of maintaining independence amongst older people. The way you answer some of the question already this morning, it seems that we not achieve this because some of the funding ended up in care homes. So how that does really answer the national outcome of maintaining independence among older people? Are we going in the wrong direction? Are we not putting the funding where the funding should be?
I think if you look at the 2020 vision statement, which is about people being cared for at home or in a homely setting, then yes, fundamentally the funding is going in one direction and the policy is in another direction. So, and that is something that's the reason that we've gone down the road now of integration of health and social care. And I think, as I said earlier, that there are things that we can drive out of the system, because there are barriers. There are things that go on that, frankly, in an integrated health and care system just shouldn't go on. And we will resolve some of those issues, and we'll stop some of the people being caught in the referral pathways and things that goes on just now. But fundamentally, yes, the investment just now, because of the demand at the front door in acute services, the investment in many boards is going into creating extra resources within acute services, because the demand is there. And really what we need to do, and I think it's Professor Mercer's point, is we need to redraw the line in the community and say that actually that's where we need to begin to manage more demand now. That was part of the objective, obviously, of the reshaping care for older people, was about was about managing some of that demand and developing services within the community. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that nothing good's been done. There's been a lot of really good work done, particularly around dementia care and around developing some of the home care aspects, but specialist aspects. And there has been a lot of really good work done in the third sector. But it hasn't actually shifted the mainstream, because the change, the reshaping care for older people was what, about 1%, and actually what we need to do is shift the 99% of investment that's currently invested in health and social work, and that's really what we're grappling with at the moment, and that's what I think we need to do. My view is that absolutely what we should begin to do much more. In some areas we'll have done this much more, but we are out consulting just now and looking at what our future model will be, is that we build that around primary care and particularly around general practice, and that we begin to shift that way. But there is a fundamental question about how do we actually begin to do more of that preventive work, more of that work in the community that stops people turning up at A&E, whilst we're still having to build. In Ayrshire, we're building for better care, it's called. We're building new assessment units at the front of the hospital in relation to A&E so that we can manage some of the demand. So it's that bit about trying to manage the demand at A&E, but at the same time we need to begin to say, if we're not investing enough in community and particularly in primary care and in general practice, I would agree absolutely, then you know we're not going to be able to shift that. And that's what we need to attempt to do next. So part of what we're looking at just now is how can we free some resource to begin to invest that in the long term. And we've obviously, the government have announced the Integrated Care Fund, which in North Ayrshire terms is 2.9 million. Our total budget is 200 million. So, but what we are focused on just now is how can we use that to make the change and free up some resource that then begins to focus. But that's kind of, in a way, could also be, it's not going to shift the mainstream. The most of the money is invested in the hospitals. And the big question for us now is how do you begin to reduce the use of hospital care and increase the services that we can offer, and in better services, more joined up services within the community that prevent people turning up at A&E and then being admitted because, as Joe says, you know, we don't know what to do with them. And so people are admitted, and then, and I do think that once you're admitted, then there's a whole thing about, you know, lack of what that does to older people's, not just older people, to anybody with multiple morbidity and other, all of us, in fact, when you, the way in which your confidence is impacted, the way in which it then becomes more difficult to return home. And I do think we still have a mindset about care home, because it moves the person on. And for me, that's one of the things that we will begin to tackle and that we need to tackle. But we need to do this in conjunction with colleagues in acute and secondary care, because it has to be done on a system-wide basis. So the short answer is we've got some short-term money that will begin to help us if we focus it, and we will focus it this time very much, learning from reshaping care on the change that we need to make in terms of the partnership. But in the longer term, we need to begin to find ways to begin to reduce what we're spending on inpatient care and move it over to the community, and that won't be easy.
So did we do it back to front? Do you think that we should have maybe, you know, like we heard already saying, spending to save, we should have maybe done more of the spending where it really need to be, which is at A&E? I was at the Grampian NHS board meeting a few weeks mm-hmm. back, and they talked about, is there really we need to first invest to make sure that this third number of patients don't get admission at the hospital? Yeah. And how do we change that culture? So do you think, you know, I've seen some of the programs starting from 2011, maybe the funding has not gone to the right places at the start, and we are starting to learn that maybe we should direct our funding more to change that culture?
I think it's hard to say, because I think that they're responding to a demand at the front door and they're trying to manage what is happening currently. And so I do think that we need to plan more in terms of the financial investment in the health service and look to see, we do now need to look at how we are going to shift the investment out of hospital-based services, and by that I mean large hospitals, because we also have a number of small hospitals. I manage a number of small hospitals as well, but to begin to shift that into primary care in particular. So Do I think they were wrong to do things like building for better care, assessment units? No, not particularly, because they're doing that in order to deliver the best possible care that they can to the people who are currently turning up at A&E. And a lot of the general practitioners have been involved in that work as well. What we need to do is improve pathways, and we actually need to focus a bit more on prevention and building community services so that people don't feel that they have their only option is to go to A&E. And I think I can only speak for Ayrshire in this respect, that we focused very much on getting better pathways around enablement, as Joe has talked about, and re-abling people and getting them out of hospital quicker and reducing the length of stay. And we haven't focused as much as we should have on how do we prevent those admissions. But to be honest, that's quite a hard thing to do unless the system's joined up. And now we've made a leap forward in terms of joining the system up in a much more cohesive way through bringing the services together.
Actually, just throw a question to the witnesses. You're talking about primary care. If primary care is the key, is there issues with GPs being independent contractors? How would that actually work? Professor Mercer.
Okay, well, a very a thorny issue, of course, mm-hmm. because GPs have been independent contractors since the NHS was established in mm-hmm. 1948. And there's mixed views across the board as to whether that's a good thing or not. My personal feeling is that despite the independent contractors status, GPs have been and still are and will be an integral part of the NHS, and are seen as that. And what independent status gives, one of the advantages, I think, is flexibility. And GPs generally can respond quite quickly to, if they're asked by government to respond to something such as the flu epidemic or so on, they can mobilise quickly. They're good at that. I think having independent contractor status probably helps that. I wouldn't go on record saying that I'm totally for it or against it. I think there's different models, but I don't think it's fundamentally a huge problem. We do, of course, have the GP contract, the GMS contract and the QOF quality outcome framework, and these are ways in which GPs across the UK are incentivized in terms of targets, and I think again whether that's been a good thing or not is controversial. I think it's certainly reduced variation between practices, but my feeling about the QOF is that it's entirely disease based and it's entirely single disease based. So even within a GP practice, you have a single disease mindset. Do this for diabetics, do this for heart disease. And actually, it's the same patients who have got all of these things. So there's no reward system for high quality care for patients with multi-morbidity. We don't have targets for that. We don't even know how to measure it. So I think the way in which the incentives are pointed will need to change at some point in the future. Now, increasingly, Scotland has a slightly different contract from England in terms of some parts of the QOF. There's been talk of, a Scottish contract, but that hasn't happened, and so on. So I think this is something for the future. But certainly, I think independent contractor status isn't a disadvantage. I think generally it allows GPs to be quite responsive to need, but I think the way in the pay for performance aspect of it, which is what the QOF is, will need to be revisited year on year, because it doesn't really fit. It fits with a very disease specific framework, and I think again the backdrop to all of this and the talk about hospital care and so on, the point is we're working it on a 19th century model. Okay, hospitals were set up because of infectious diseases, and you went in, you got treated, you got better, you came out, and that model fundamentally hasn't really changed. But the needs of the population has completely changed, and now the big problem facing Scotland and the rest of the world is non-communicable diseases, chronic diseases. And if we were building a health service today from scratch, it wouldn't look anything like the one we've got. So clearly, of course, this incremental change has to go on. But that's a fundamental problem, having people divided up into these single conditions, which doesn't always make much sense to them, or indeed to the doctors.
Can I ask you very quickly, then we'll let Joe in. Joe's sitting patiently waiting in the background. You mentioned that the NHS, if it was to be redesigned, it wouldn't be built on the model it is just now. How would it be redesigned then? What would be your suggestion for it?
Well, gosh, if I could wave a magic wand, what would I do? It should be designed entirely around the patient, so it should be truly person-centred, so that the needs of that person as a person, not as a set of diseases, is what's important. So within that, you've got all the good things about patient-centred care, shared decision-making, priority setting, goal setting, and so on, driven by the patient. Now, of course, we have policy directions for that, but I don't think it always happens in the way it could. And the integration of health and social care, of course, that would be starting from scratch. We would be working together with the same systems, the same computer systems to talk to each other. We'd know each other. We'd have good relationships. Things would be community-based, largely. Hospitals would be a thing of the future that very few people would have to go into. So it would be turning the pyramid we've got just now absolutely upside down. And clearly that can't happen overnight, but I feel that will have to be the future if we're going to continue with the NHS.
Yeah, thank you, Joel. Thank you for patiently waiting.
No, it's just really agreeing with what Professor Mercer has said around that we need to make that shift from single disease pathways. But on the contract, one of the things that has happened in the kind of latest iteration of the contract with GPs is a very small part of the QoF has been allocated to the commitment by the GP practice to engage with their locality, partners. And that's been, we've seen a shift from that. So that's a kind of a positive example of how the contract can be utilised to actually incentivise engagement within the development of a locality model. In other words, development of an integrated model, because it's in with that integrated locality focus that is in the legislation, and the GPs will be absolutely central to the successful delivery of that.
Thank you very much. Christian?
To go back to the budget, the integrated model is good, but we have here in Parliament, we need to scrutinise exactly how the funding is dispersed, and if it's measured, if we get any measurement of how this integrated funding is happening, and do you think we can measure already some of the outcomes, or do you think it's too early? Do you need to wait a few years to be able to measure exactly if it made a real difference, if its funding made a very difference? So can we have an assessment soon, you think?
On this question of evaluation and measurement, we would say yes, it is possible to demonstrate, in terms of the reshaping care spend that there has been, there is that shift. The spend within the third sector, just to take that as an example, in North Lanarkshire, we made a decision at the beginning of the programme that 20% of spend on reshaping from the reshaping care budget would be spent within the third sector, and then we established a rigorous evaluation framework around that. So it was kind of lots of, sometimes very, very small initiatives around, for example, digital inclusion, so maybe a small local group in one part of North Lanarkshire saying we're interested in connecting young volunteers it's second nature to them to use an iPad, connecting them with older people who want to learn how to use that, and that then has very strong connections to their being included, their combating loneliness because they have different ways of connecting with their family, if their family are at a distance and so on. But with each of those projects, we have actually established a framework where there is regular reporting, quarterly reporting on, well, okay, you got this money, so what has actually been achieved? And there's actually quantitative reporting, so the Voluntary Action North Lanarkshire are able to actually say, this number of people learned how to use an iPad, this number of people got a telephone wellbeing check. And so it is actually possible to establish that kind of measurement framework. It's labour intensive, but if we don't do that, then we won't be able to actually make the case for that wider transfer of the resource that we're talking about this morning from the acute into this sector, because it's always going to be difficult to demonstrate that by actually doing that kind of work, education around falls, for example, it's always going to be difficult to evidence the connection between that and less people in hospital. But as long as we actually can evidence the contributions, we have a contribution story that is regularly published on a quarterly basis, summarising all of this information, then we're making the case for that transfer.
That's one of the ways to measure it. Any other ways to measure it?
Sorry. There are 9 national outcomes which have been set for the health and social care partnerships. And obviously we're just currently working on how we're going to report on those 9 national outcomes. And they are very much about, as Professor Mercer spoke about person-centred and about what difference interventions make to the outcomes for people's lives. So we're working through that just now in terms of how we will be able to do that. And obviously we're working with the civil servants around the performance framework and what that's going to look like.
It's a working progress. A last question, if I may. My colleague John Mason talked about what we can do centrally. It seems to me that a lot of has been speaking about culture, the culture of the patient, how to change the culture of using any, for example, or using maybe too early or too much care homes. Really, that needs to be addressed centrally. Maybe there should be some funding allocated to have a central message, to try to promote not only the outcome, but the way, as well as the different way you are working across the nation and making sure that we have single message trying to tell people, older people, the same message. How do we go about that, if not centrally?
Sure. Yeah. Within North Lanarkshire, one of the things that we did in terms of message and communication, one of the things that we did with reshaping care monies was to appoint a communications officer who actually came from the media, came from working for one of the national papers, and he has had tremendous impact in terms of actually taking all of the kinds of the stories that I'm talking about this morning and many, many more, examples of work that has been happening in ensuring that those messages are actually out there in all of the local media fora that we have, including kind of radio but also the local newspapers are a very important part of that. So there is a strong commitment to actually putting the message across. I think that the message comes from also how we engage, as services, we make very clear the things that I've been talking about around the role of the third sector, the importance of the small initiative within a community which builds its capacity. By actually putting the funding into that, we're giving a message to the community that this is really vitally important. It's not something that we treat as a bolt on. And I suppose the example that I would give, again, I talked earlier about reablement and the change in the approach to delivering home support. And when we began to do that, we anticipated that we would have a lot of real difficulty from the public, because they were their expectation built up over decades was that when you started with a home support service, you remained with that service for the rest of perhaps the rest of your life, or until you went into a care home. And and there were many examples of that. You know, so people who went into a hospital who were unwell and had a home support service before they went in because they were waiting for a hip replacement. When they came out, they needed a bit more during their rehabilitation, but, you know, the medical, you know, opinion was that, you know, 2 months after the hip replacement, they should actually be better than they were before they started using the service. So they, you know, but they would continue in the service in a historical model, and that wasn't an effective use of resource. So, but going back to the engagement with the public, in our experience, people understood, they really understood, as long as we explained and our staff understood that part of their job was to actually communicate with the wider public. And, you know, that we had very small numbers of people where there was real difficulty, and the anxiety was around people saying, well, I know that I don't need the home support service for the things that it's meant to come in and do, but this is my contact with the outside world. This is about loneliness. So you have to then also demonstrate you're taking that seriously. So you are actually developing the alternative approaches to actually how you do loneliness. You're not just saying, well, we're going to reduce this home support service because we've introduced reablement and we're not concerned with the wider issue which is actually being addressed. So the engaging, actually, you know, modelling what we do and explaining it is absolutely vitally important. And yes, it is helped by national level messages, and that focus is also helpful, but it's not either or, it has to be happening nationally and locally.
Christian, is that you finished now? Siobhan, would you like to take over?
Please. I was going to ask about transition services, but Iona, you mentioned in one of your contributions about preventative spend, and I just wondered if people understand what that actually means, or are we using different definitions across the board? I think that's coming up anecdotally in a lot of evidence that we're getting, both at committee and otherwise, that maybe our understanding of what preventative spend is may not be what service users believe it is, or those who are implementing policy. So I was just wondering if we had a definition that you worked to.
Well, a lot of the prevention work that we've kind of split it between prevention and earlier intervention. And I think when we're talking about adult services, a lot of it's more about earlier intervention. So it's about intervening earlier. It's probably Joe can probably tell us, because North Lanarkshire have very well-developed self-directed support. And, you know, we've also developed self-directed support, but North Lanarkshire have led the way on that. I think there's a bit about, you know, providing services at an earlier point so that you're preventing people becoming sicker, becoming more frail. So if we think about the traditional way that local authorities have rationed services is by having eligibility criteria. So you have to actually be in quite a high level of need before you reach that criteria in order to be able to access the service. And that's a kind of traditional, that, and as local authorities have particularly had to deal with reduced budgets, that's been one of the things that's been revisited. And I think that what we've begun to do through the Change Fund and through self-directed support is actually to look at, can you make smaller payments to people in self-directed support so that they can buy in services that actually will support them better. That reduces their kind of long-term dependence and also gives them much more say over the care that they have. Or can we do things like give people some of the aids, for example, for people with disabilities at an earlier stage rather than wait until they reach the criteria? So that's some of the work that we've been doing around older people and people with disability services. In children's services, we're focused particularly around trying to prevent children coming into the social work system, because we know that once they're in the social work system, you know, many children have to come into the social work system and should quite rightly be in the social work system, but we're trying to prevent some of the harm that happens to children at an earlier level. And so we've been doing some examples in North Ayrshire would be things like we have a multi-agency team based in Kilmarnock Police Station which works around domestic abuse. And that team basically goes out with police officers the day after there's been a domestic abuse incident. What we've done through that is we've massively reduced the length of time it takes to respond to women. It's mainly women, it's not always women, and their children, very importantly their children. We've reduced the number of referrals to the children's reporter. We've reduced the number of requests for further reports, and we've got women and children into safety much, much faster. And for the first time in many years, we have seen a decrease in the levels of reported domestic violence in Ayrshire, in North Ayrshire. That's one example. We're doing other things like working in early and around the early years centres and putting in money advice and putting in social workers as well. So it's about focusing particularly there around families who are on the edge of the system and trying to assist them so that they don't actually have to get to that terrible point of need or where a family breakdown or where there's something happens to a child. So I suppose those are the different, and we tend to badge them all as prevention and early intervention, but clearly, you know, they have a different focus.
But I'm glad of all the great work that's been happening, but I think the phrase that you used was intervening earlier. I think that brings me then to transition services, because we've heard in evidence about young people falling through the gap, older people maybe not being prioritised in the group that they wish, and therefore, if they had been identified earlier, those things may not happen. So I'm just wondering then how a better transitional approach can be supported in the new integration framework that we have. Do you see room for improvement there? What are the types of things that we should be looking for across the board? I know different areas are working different ways, but you know, I represent 3 local authority areas. I don't want to see a young person getting a better service just because they live a few miles away from someone else. So what should we be looking for as we look at the budget?
I suppose in terms of prevention, how your question was about definition of prevention. I see prevention as, you know, supporting people to live, you know, as full lives as possible within their capabilities, capacities, and avoiding the need for more intensive level of service intervention. And I think one example or one area where we're really kind of focused is around how can we use technologies, you know, new technologies, you know. So the development, one of the things that we know in terms of older people is that on that kind of identification is that people will often actually come too late, they will themselves come looking for assistance when it's too late. So, or they come to our attention without the person coming to assistance. So a serious fall quite often happens after, we know from research, the person has had several falls already, you know, and we may not, no one outside the person's family may know about that fall. And sometimes people will actually themselves conceal the fact that they're having the fall because they think as soon as we actually open this up, then there's going to be a massive level of intervention. I might have to go into care, you know. So what we're trying to do in terms of technology is to, we've developed a website, Making Life Easier, which allows people to access information without in fact having to go to a service, because we know that, you know, and we will probably, many of us will know from our own direct experience of having an older relative who say, well, I think it's time you got some help, and I'm sure there are things that we could do to help you, and no, I don't want to be referred to social work. But that's a dialogue, a conversation happening with people who are on one side of the conversation are very internet capable, then actually say, well, let's have a look on a website and see what is there in this local authority area. And then they will come to a website which says, well, here's information about falls prevention. Here's information about small aids and adaptations, which we can actually order online and actually get delivered without ever making that referral into formal service. And that's an area where we see great potential for prevention and actually the person actually not having to come into the formal service or delaying the point where they have to come into formal service. And that is more acceptable to many people themselves, because some of the issue around not being identified is that people don't want to be identified in the existing, you know, service configuration.
Again, though, just back to how you identify that those services so that people don't fall through the gap. So I understand the example you gave, Joe, but if you're not competent on a computer, you know, you don't have a supportive family, you're on your own, you don't want to bother anybody, you know, you don't want to tell people you're fallen, where do you go there? How are those people identified? How is a young person who has gone to school, so for instance in primary school, and it's all on one level and everything's wonderful for them and they get the support there, and then they find themselves in high school and it's on three levels and no one really understood that because they weren't doing home economics or technical studies that they would have a problem when they got there. How are those young people identified, and how does the integration that we're now seeing, you know, be it, you know, the public bodies, but whatever that may be, how does that then support young people and older people who are in those circumstances?
The questions as well, thanks.
Okay, right. In Ayrshire and Larne, we've put in children's services into the partnership, so it's children's services and criminal justice are within, and that for the reasons you're talking about, because of that issue about transitions, and so how we can plan better for children. We know the children with disabilities coming through the system, so it's about better planning and knowing who those children are. I think in terms of your general question, I suppose that the big ideas that in terms of the strategic approach are for children, it's very much about how do we build a multidisciplinary approach around children, teams around children in early years in primary and secondary, and for children who are out of school, so that we actually do pick kids up, and that we're doing some work just now with Dartington Social Research Company, which will identify what children are seeing in each of the school cluster areas. And for adults, it's very much about, I think it's about attaching ourselves to general practice and building the pathways around general practice and integrating the services, because that's where most people will go, is to see their GP, or their GP will likely be the first person that gets involved. And I think we need to recognise that and then basically do what we need to do around facilitating then the services around GPs and being able to move people through and into the right part of the system, and to take some of the burden off the GPs and to work hand in hand with them to deliver it.
Just briefly, just to mention, there's an example of that is a project that myself and colleagues are evaluating called the Deep End Link Worker project, which the Cabinet Secretary announced funding for the next 2 to 3 years. And this is exactly for the situation where, you know, there could be a lot of community support in an area, but the people who are isolated, and the GPs themselves will often not know what's out in the community, particularly in deprived areas, because they don't live there. So the link worker is a fairly highly skilled person, often from a community development background, and they're actually physically in the GP's practices, taking referrals. So when a GP sees a patient and picks up, actually, I think this person's isolated, they can refer to the link worker, who will see them next day, and then go through what's available locally. There's a system called Alice, which is a kind of can be localized for all sorts of things, including, you know, somebody might run a lunch group, or somebody might run a walking group, or so on. So we're just at the very start of this. It's being done in 7 practices in Glasgow, but the good thing about it, from my point of view, I would say this, is there's a reasonable amount of money going into the evaluation, and it's being done as a randomised control trial. So there's 15 practices where we've been half of them getting the intervention, half not, and we can then compare: does it actually work? Is it cost effective? How many people get this service? You know, will it actually do what we think it's going to do? And I think that there's lots of examples of good local projects, but very often we don't evaluate them, and then nobody really pulls this together. And that for me, that's a frustration, because we do, you know, high-level academic stuff, big numbers and so on, and there's brilliant stuff happening on the ground. And I think we've got to bring those two worlds together. So I think the evaluation of that's really important. But that's one example. So link workers who are not medically qualified, don't need to be, they've got a totally different set of skills, but working very closely with health, with statutory services and third sector. And I would see that as potentially a model for the future.
Thank you.
Siobhan, can it's based on Professor Mercer. It's just about the money that's allocated, and everyone can say they want more money. So I'm not expecting that answer because that's always the answer. But 173.5 million has been set aside in the draft budget for the integration fund. Is that reasonable? I mean, Iona, you spoke about your own local authority earlier, about what that means in the grand scheme of things. Can you do all the things that you wish to do with that money? Is that a reasonable task of you, given the current climate, or isn't it? Not, I understand, as I said, we all want more money, but is it a reasonable?
What it depends how we use it, and if we use it to change service, so we in Ayrshire would want to use it to make the changes so that we integrate the health and social care components so that we're making best use of the resource we've got, and that we do something very similar to what Professor Mercer has described there with the GPs. And I think that will begin to make some of the changes. It's not enough to make the big shift, as we've talked about earlier, but we need to use it to begin to make inroads into making the big shift. It's not enough, and because we've only been guaranteed it and we understand why for a year, it's not enough to set up a whole lot of new services. It's about changing the way that we currently use the services, and our proposals are kind of similar to the ones that Professor Mercer's talked about.
Thank you. Can I just check, John Finney, do you want to ask any questions? Have they been covered?
They've been covered. Thank you,
Convener. Okay, thank you. Alex, are you happy to ask them?
There was a subject that Professor Mercer mentioned earlier on. It was the issue of the distribution of primary care and how it tends to be fairly even across the country and doesn't reflect demand. I wanted to ask you if the planning aspects of the integration of health and social care are taking proper account of that?
Yeah, to the best of my knowledge, no. I don't think that is taken into account. And this is this flat distribution. You know, when it's historic. GP numbers are really distributed in terms of largely population count, numbers of people, and there's some inflation given for working in deprived areas and so on. But no, I haven't heard of anything that takes that into account. Now, last week, I think the Cabinet Secretary announced an extra £43 million over the year, over the next year, which will go into deprived areas and general practice in deprived areas. So that's very welcome. We don't know yet how that would be spent. It's only for 1 year. So it won't solve the fundamental problem, but it's certainly a step in the right direction. But I haven't seen, no, I don't know of anything that will reverse the inverse care law.
So are GPs being properly taken into the integration process?
Well, I think the inclusion of the GPs in locality planning and so on is very welcome. I mean, I think the GPs need to be involved in that. I don't know how uniform that is across Scotland. It tends to be piecemeal, I think. But there's not, in terms of the health inequalities and deprivation, then it's still a kind of a level playing field. And in the face of a relative decrease in the spend on GPs over the years. So I don't think it's going to fundamentally change from what I've seen.
In terms of GP involvement, it's absolutely fundamental that they are involved in the integration process because they're part of the solution here, and we can't deliver what we need to deliver without them. So we have been engaging with them directly, and they are represented, certainly in Ayrshire, they're represented on they will be represented on the integration joint boards. They're currently on the shadow board. We've got a job to do with GPs because I think that they feel quite disenfranchised from what's gone before, from the community health partnerships and the rest. Now, that will vary across the country, but I know that's the case in Ayrshire. So it's very much about talking to them and engaging with them. So we are meeting with them on a regular basis, and I think that we are saying very clearly that they need to be part of the solution because we can't resolve all of these issues unless GPs are absolutely at the heart of it. And we would plan also to have GP leadership within our management team as well.
In terms of outcomes for older people, will self-directed support have any effect on changing the balance?
Yeah, self-directed support, it will support the continued focus on balance of care. It will give some people choices and options to manage their own support in a way that they didn't perhaps feel was available to them before we had the legislation, and it's certainly a big part of taking of moving into the future in terms of balance of care. Clearly, for there will be differential uptake of the different options, under self-directed support. But we're certainly in North Lanarkshire seeing more older people, so more older people actually coming into the using the option of taking individual budget. That will not be the case for everybody. Everybody won't want that.
The final question on that, Ron, is the budget adequate?
Well, I think you probably know the answer to that question, but in terms of the change funds don't change the fundamentals of the budget. They give an opportunity to reshape and to redesign and to take to just take a step back and say, Professor Mercer's point earlier, if you kind of started with a clean sheet, the change funds allow us to do a little bit of that, and it's very, very welcome to be able to do that. Certainly, delivering within the current budgets is a really big challenge, and we know that the coming years are going to be harder still again, but as your colleague was saying, we can't just keep coming saying, well, we want more money, because we actually know what the answer to that is also. So we have to find different ways of working. We have to work with some of the principles that have been set out very clearly in the Christie report to say, how can we actually reshape what we do within the reality, the financial realities that we work in?
Thank you.
I think John Finney may want to come in on this.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of very brief questions. One regarding what the specific purpose of the integrated care funding will be. What uses will it be put to, please?
The way that we've approached it in North Ayrshire, and in fact, I think the other two Ayrshires have done the same thing, is we're looking at what needs to be, what the legacy is of reshaping care of older people, what bits of that we would want to sustain and change over the next 12 months. And that won't be the major part of it. We're looking at around about a third to look at how we change what we're doing, so that how we integrate, for example, we've got two mental health teams. We've got a social work mental health team and an NHS mental health team. We've got an NHS learning disability team and a social work learning disability team. We've got a number of areas for older people. We've got some separate services. So one of the things we're going to focus on is putting those together, reducing duplication and having that kind of those multidisciplinary teams. So by the end of the 12 months, we should have the multidisciplinary teams. The other focus is how do we attach it?
Sorry, can I interrupt? Yep. Some people might assume that that would bring savings rather than acquire costs. But
yes, some people might. Especially my director of finance.
Okay.
So there will be some
Ultimately,
there will be savings, because we will reduce, and we will reduce already because we've already set up a partnership management team. So it's one management team that manages all of the resource, including the whole of mental health. So there are savings there in terms of management structures. There will be savings because we will not do things two or three times as we currently do. We'll do them once. It'll take a bit of time to get to that. But I think that the demand increases are what's challenging all of us, because the demand has continued to increase as the budget has decreased. And so currently, just now in North Ayrshire, we have about £2.5 million worth of overspend in older people's services related to care at home and care homes. And that's not meeting the totality of the need. So that's the challenge for us, is how do we manage to do this and stay within budget or within an acceptable level for our elected members. But the other part of it is how do we attach then to primary care and particularly to general practice, and that's the bit of the model that we want to work through. So it's very much about the kinds of things that Professor Mercer talked about, but actually so we can organise services differently. And then the third part of the budget we've put out is an innovation fund, which has been organised by our third sector colleagues. And they're running that basically to look at what innovative types of approaches the third and independent sector might want to come up. Probably smaller schemes, but focused around some of the issues that Joe was raising there in terms of some of those services and providing support to people. One of the problems in reshaping care for older people was it was quite strict and it had to be focused on over 65. And as we've discussed already today, actually, particularly in areas like Irvine and the Three Towns, you have people who are in their 40s and their 50s who are just as sick. So that was one of the problems. And so that's partly what we need to look at. What did we learn from that, the reshaping care that was good, that we would want to extend? But what else do we want to do that's new? And working hand in hand with the third sector to get their best ideas generated as well.
OK. Can I pose a very quick question to the Professor? Please.
Answer, please, yes. Professor Mercer.
Professor, you raised the sum of the £43 million, and last week I represent the Highlands and Islands, and I asked the largest health board there, had they any intimation of how that cost would be spent? Now, a lot of the discussion's been about urban deprivation. You'll be aware that rural deprivation, when it's compounded with issues of geography, are significant. Is enough attention being paid to that in the budget formula?
To rural
areas. As you know, there are particular challenges getting medical services and innovative ways of trying to deliver them, not least connected with the GP contracts.
I'm not too sure the detail on that, but in general terms, the issue in the rural areas of the ageing population is worse. Mm-hmm. So it's the Highlands and the Islands are ageing faster than the urban areas. So again, the problems will accelerate, but I'm not sure if enough has been done. I don't know if what my colleagues would say.
I think, I don't know if we have time for that, but thank you very much.
Running out of time. Marco would like to ask some questions now, thanks.
I've heard a lot about how well things are working with the third sector in North Lanarkshire. Is it working as well in the other 31 local authorities?
Well, I think it's working quite well in North Ayrshire, but I would say that I think that certainly in Ayrshire, the third sector have been very much engaged in the work that we've done to set up the health and social care partnership. Because we've been working on this for nearly 2 years now. Our council agreed about 18 months ago about what model we would look at and all the services that we'd be putting in, and we've been working in partnership across the three Ayrshires and with the health board to create the structures, and the third sector have been involved all the way along.
Would you say your experience is... Well, I'm seeing shaking of head from next to you, so maybe I won't finish that question. I'll just pass over. Yep.
Okay. I think it's from the point of view of integration between the third sector and, say, primary care and general practice, it's at a very early stage. Some areas have got historically much better links. For example, in Craigmillar in Edinburgh, a high deprivation area, they've got 20, 30 years of having good relationships between the general practice and the local organisations such as the Thistle Foundation. You go to an equally deprived part of Glasgow and you just don't have that. So it's not the same across the piece. We finished a project recently with the Royal College of General Practitioners called Improving Links in Primary Care. And this is exactly the aim of the project. And we looked at four different practices and we worked with them for about 2 years. What was clear that one model doesn't fit each area. So the idea, although the policy is good, each local area has to do this in their own way. For example, in one of the practices we worked with, it was in a very affluent area. There was a lot of elderly people and a lot of commuters. And their needs were very different from the the needs in Craigmillar in terms of the types of linkage required. In the more affluent patch, they didn't need link workers because actually people were quite able to fight to look at a directory and so on. But they did need the communication with the practice. So I think this is, from my point of view as a primary care practitioner and researcher, it's at a very early stage. The Alliance for Health and Social Care, of course, is a big player in this and is doing really good work. But we shouldn't think that this can be rolled out as one size fits all. It's going to evolve over time. The deep end link worker is one example, but that model may not work across the piece. So I think this is going to take 5 years before we really know how to do this well.
Is it the case then that you could have third sector providers working quite well at the strategic level for the board and possibly delivering services almost in parallel in certain areas and having communication but maybe not connecting at the GP line unless there's a history of it and taking time? Is that...
I think that's entirely possible.
That's what I'm taking from that.
Yeah, but it's important to note, and I think that I can see why that happens, because it's about the history of and who holds the contracts, but the partnership will hold the contracts. So if you look at the social care budget for North Ayrshire, which is about £95 million, half of that is spent in the third and independent sector. So, and really the approach that we've taken is they are our key partners going into this partnership along with everybody else. So that should, if it works properly, bring those relationships that Professor Mercer's talking about as we tie in the third sector as well.
Final question then, is there enough financial emphasis coming from the centre and recognisable funding streams coming from the centre to support the need to develop working with the third sector?
Is that me? Yes. Well,
whoever would like.
Well, from a primary care point of view, I think not. I think it's at an early stage. The deep end link worker project has been well funded and well supported, but it is only six practices, and there is a question as to whether that level of funding would actually be, if it's a big success, would it actually be rolled out, and or would it be too costly? That's why we need good evaluation, including health economic evaluation, because if you can show these sorts of interventions to be cost effective, then of course it takes on a very different slant. So I think it's early days, I think from a general practice point of view, the answer would almost certainly be no. We're just starting on this journey.
Sorry, a quick yes or no. Is that project, is that funded directly from Central Scottish Government or from the relevant board? Scottish Government.
Scottish Government, as far as I know.
Thank you. Through
the Alliance.
Could I ask if any members have got any final questions they'd like to ask before we finish up? No? Okay. Can I thank the witnesses for coming along this morning? It's been very, very informative, and I'm sure we could have gone on for another 2 or 3 hours or more. But that, unfortunately, concludes today's meeting, and our next meeting will take place on Thursday, the 20th of November. And thank you again for coming along. Thank you.